Welcome to Bible Tract Echoes. This program is the radio ministry of Bible Tracts Incorporated. Our mission is to take the Word of God to all the world. Our Bible teacher is the director of Bible Tracts, Pastor Mark Smith. Since 1938, Bible Tracts Incorporated has been publishing clear gospel tracts and supplying them to churches, missionaries, and individuals all over the world, and all at no charge. Information on how you can receive a free sample pack of our tracts will be given at the end of this broadcast. Now for our Bible study, here is our teacher, Pastor Mark Smith.
Hello, my friend. Welcome to the broadcast today. Thank you for joining us for this time of Bible study and a time where we nudge each other to be involved in telling the gospel, the good news of salvation, to people who have yet either never have heard it or have yet rejected the gospel, and we tell them again. I hope you can stay with us for the entire time. Right now, my Bible sits open to the book of Ruth, Ruth chapter 3. If at all possible, reach over, pick up your own copy of the Word of God, and join me there in Ruth chapter 3. I'll begin to read at verse 1. You may also want to get a piece of paper and something with which you can write, not only to take down some notes as I give the outline for our study, but also in a few minutes, I'll be asking you to order a free sample packet of our gospel tracts. I've got one of the tracts here in my hand, and just in case you don't know what a gospel tract is a short written presentation of God's plan of salvation. I want to give you some free gospel tracts. For 81 years, this ministry has been giving away gospel tracts, and I want to give you some. But let me get us into the Bible study this way. Have you ever heard this phrase, "Behold, I set before thee an open door"? Well, those words come from the book of the Revelation, chapter 3 and verse 8, and they were spoken by Christ to the messenger, the pastor for the church there in the city of Philadelphia. Now, obviously, this is not Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. This is the Philadelphia located in Asia Minor. The door being referred to here was a gospel, a good news opportunity. God had opened to this church a great opportunity to preach good news to lost people. And this open door phrase, you're going to hear it often at mission conference situations. Well, we're here in Ruth chapter 3. And in the opening five verses, the godly lady Naomi senses that God has opened a door of good news for Ruth. Now, if God opens doors of opportunity, then this door ought to be walked through. And that's exactly what Naomi is going to be instructing her daughter-in-law, Ruth, to do. Naomi has already sensed that God is working on their behalf. Now, even more hope is going to be revealing itself in her heart. But first, she and Ruth, they've got to act. They must walk through an open door by faith. Get your Bible. Get something with which you can jot some notes. I mentioned the gospel tracts here a moment ago. The one particular tract in my hand right now is a tract for older elementary age young people. It's entitled, "Are You in Danger? Are You in Danger?" This gospel tract begins with a story, a true story, about our founder when he was 12 years of age. He's out in a rowboat initially with an adult, but that adult had to be let off on shore. And at 12 years of age, he's out in this rowboat in a thunderstorm, and the only light he has to steer the boat to the proper location is the lightning that's coming down. Friend, this is a great read. You'll love reading this story, even to your young people, as well as them reading it for themselves. But it goes on to say that the young boy did not realize he was in danger because of the lightning. And it makes the point that so many people do not realize they are in danger because nobody's told them of the hellfire that's to come if people do not receive Jesus Christ as Savior. This is a great, great gospel tract for kiddos. If you've got grandkids, great tract to read to them. Give out to the neighbor kids. Just one of the 40 tracts in a sample packet I want to send to you. Please let me do that. At the end of the program, my announcer will give to you our contact information. Be ready to jot it down. Give us your name and your mailing address, or go to our website. Our web address is BibleTractsInc.org. Do that, please. Please do that today. If your Bible's open to Ruth chapter 3, verse 1 says this, "Then Naomi, her mother-in-law, said unto her, My daughter, shall I not seek rest for thee, that it may be well with thee? And now is not Boaz of our kindred, whose maidens thou hast wast? Behold, he went with barley tonight in the threshing floor. Wash thyself, therefore, and anoint thee, and put thy raiment upon thee, and get thee down to the floor. But make not thyself known unto the man until he have eaten, done eating, and drinking. And it shall be, when he lieth down, that thou shalt mark the place where he shall lie, and thou shalt go in and uncover his feet, and lie thee down, and he will tell thee what thou shalt do. And she said unto her, All that thou sayest unto me, I will do." Stop, please, right there. Now, last Friday, I explained why that these five verses are the focal point of the whole book of Ruth. There are 10 key segments of the book leading up to this paragraph, and there are 10 key segments leading away from this paragraph. And what transpires here brings joy and rest and peace to Ruth and Naomi, and the rest of the book uncovers and shows all that, but it all comes because of the decision of faith and action that these two ladies here take. Now, my outline title for verses 1 through 5 is the word consultation. Consultation. Here, Naomi wisely gives Ruth advice on how to take the next step. Naomi's goal here is to find long-term rest for Ruth. And that rest meant that Ruth would find a new husband, have a home and children, and be secure for the rest of her life. But again, last Friday, I used the word security to help identify what we see happening in verse 1. Let's come now today to verse 2, and I move from the word security in verse 1 to the word status that I'm going to use for my outline title for verse 2. The word is status. Naomi has already recognized that this man Boaz had taken a major interest in Ruth. This interest had been shown through two harvest seasons. Naomi now consults with Ruth about the status of Boaz, and she makes two key statements. Number one is that Boaz is a kinsman. He's a close family relative. And number two, Boaz has been kind. Verse 2 uses the word kindred. That means he's family. But the verse also says that Naomi reminds Ruth that Boaz's kindness has been seen and how he let Ruth be right among his maidens, his hired workers. Just in case you're not familiar with Jewish laws and customs from the Old Testament law made provision for a family member, a kinsman, to redeem another family member out of various precarious situations. For example, if a Jewish person was sold into slavery due to poverty, a kinsman could buy their freedom. They could redeem them. Another redemption is called a levirate marriage. This made it possible for a widow to escape her condition by marrying a single brother of her deceased husband. Now, this man then would typically raise up children to perpetuate the family line of the deceased brother. But still another redemption plan was that when a close family member could buy back the property of the dead man. You see, when a man, in this case Ruth's husband, when he died, he lost control of the property. A kinsman redeemer could purchase the property, he could take control of it, but he also had to take the widow in as his own. Well, the status of Boaz was that he was a close relative, and he had a heart that cared about Ruth's condition. He had displayed that openly, not only just to her, but in front of others. Now, just in case you've never heard somebody preach or teach on the book of Ruth before, here is a key point that you and I are supposed to see here. Boaz in the book of Ruth is a picture of Jesus. Boaz could redeem Ruth out of her desperate condition because he was a near kinsman. He was connected to the family. Well, Jesus came to earth, took on flesh, and dwelt among us. He became part of the human family. In the book of Hebrews, chapter 2, verses 14 and 15, here's what we read. I'm reading now, "For as much then as the children," speaking of people, "the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he," that is Jesus, "he also himself likewise took part of the same." He took part of flesh and blood. That, a purpose statement's coming now, "that through death he," Jesus, "might destroy him that had the power of death," that is the devil, "and deliver them," that are the people, "deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage." But then in verse 17 of Hebrews 2, that verse ends with these words about what Jesus was doing when he came and took on flesh and became our kinsman. It says here that Jesus came to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. Remember now, Boaz purchased Ruth out of her permanent peril. Well, at least that's what we're going to see happen here as chapter 3 and chapter 4 continue. Boaz will purchase Ruth out of her permanent condition. He can do that because he is of near of kin. Jesus purchased us, that is all believers, those that put their faith in him, purchases us out of our eternal peril by shedding his blood at Calvary so that we can be reconciled to God. The word reconciled means that we can be placed into a right and into a peaceful relationship to God. Boaz was near of kin, but he also cared, so he's going to act. Jesus had to become near of kin. He had to take on flesh and dwell among us, but he loves us because you know what John 3:16 says. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son." Romans chapter 5 says that while we were yet in sin, Christ died for us. But wait a minute. The verse begins this way, "But God demonstrated his love for us in that while we were yet in sin, Christ died for us." There is an old hymn. I still love it. I've sung it all my life since I was a kid. It says this: "If you are tired of the load of your sin, let Jesus come into your heart. If you desire a new life to begin, let Jesus come into your heart. Just now let doubting be o'er. Just now throw open the door. Just now reject him no more. Let Jesus come into your heart." That, friends, is how Jesus becomes your kinsman redeemer. You say, "I'm in peril, eternal peril, because of my sin. I'm going to die in this condition, eternally die." But there's a way, there's a redeemer, a kinsman. Jesus came, took on flesh, died in my place, that I, through him, can be saved. Receive him right now. Let him save you from your sin.
Thank you for joining us today for Bible Tract Echoes. If you would like to receive a free sample packet of our tracts, you can contact us by calling 309-828-6888. Our mailing address is Bible Tracts, P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. Again, our phone number is 309-828-6888. And our mailing address is P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. You can also contact us through our website. Our web address is BibleTractsInc.org. Remember, the word tracts is spelled T-R-A-C-T-S. That address is BibleTractsInc.org. May the Lord richly bless you as you serve him.